Preemptive scheduling algorithms get more complicated. Shortest time to completion first is very much like shortest job first, but it is preemptive. So that means that whenever we have a process that enters into the system that has a shorter burst time that is left to complete, it is possible for the CPU to be taken away from the currently running process and given to a process that has just entered into the system. So in shortest time to completion, in this particular example, process one is the first in the system at time zero, and therefore it gets to run. But then at time two, process one only has four left to go, and process two that just came in has three burst time left to go. So process two is going to get to run at that point in time without having to wait. During the time that process two is executing, process three is going to come in at time four, but at that point in time, process three only has 1 millisecond left to go. And at time five, process four is going to come in at time with a CPU burst of two. But at that point in time, process two is completed. So at this point, process two gives up the CPU voluntarily, and process four is going to be able to start running without having to wait. Process four will complete after 2 milliseconds. And then at time seven, process one is still the process in the system with the shortest burst time, so it will get to run again. It will execute for its total 4 milliseconds remaining, and then at time 11, it will give up the CPU voluntarily, and process three will be allowed to run its entire 7-second burst. So why do we have two processes that didn't wait? Well, process one started at time zero, but it had to wait. It was scheduled first at time zero, but then it was taken off at time two. So at time two, it entered into the system, into the ready queue again, and it was not scheduled again until time 7 milliseconds. Process two entered into the system at time two, and it did not have to wait. It went directly onto the system. Process three entered into the system at time four, but was not scheduled until time 11, resulting in a wait time of 7. And process four has a wait time of 0 because it was scheduled as soon as it entered into the system. Now, of these particular decisions, only the one at time two represents a preemptive decision that was made. At time five and seven, and at time 11, each of those processes willingly gave up the CPU. But because this particular algorithm takes preemptive decisions into account, it is still considered a preemptive scheduling algorithm. So now you try. We have a total of three processes in our system. These are the same burst times from when we were working with the shortest job first. Process one and process three are both going to arrive at time three. However, now we get to interrupt process two. So you give it a try. Pause the video here. When you are working with shortest time to completion first, it's not a guarantee that we're only going to have three boxes here. So give yourself space to work. We are going to start with process two, and process two is going to run at least until time three. But at time three, process two is going to have a CPU burst of four left, and process three has a CPU burst time of two. So process three will get to run at that point, and it's going to continue for its full burst of two until it gets to 5 milliseconds. At that point in time, process two is going to take back over because its CPU burst time that is left of four is less than process one's CPU burst time of five. So process two will run until time nine and then give the CPU over to process one, which is going to run until completion. So just like in the last example, we had a preemptive decision that was made here at time three when other processes entered into the system, but the other scheduling decisions that were made were non-preemptive. So when we calculate our average wait time, process one entered into the system at time three, but didn't run until time nine. Process two entered into the system at time zero and was immediately scheduled, but it was kicked back to the ready queue at time three and was not scheduled again until time five. So the first version of it waiting was zero, but then it had to wait wait a little bit more when it was kicked onto the ready queue again. And process 3 did not have to wait at all. It was scheduled as soon as it entered into the system at time 0. So our average wait time as a whole will end up being 6 plus 2 plus 0, which is still going to be divided by 3 for a total of 8 over 3.